Thank you. read that, ladies and gentlemen, this morning, you will notice that in verse number one, God asks three things of Abram. He asks him to get out of his country, get away from his kindred and father's house, and go into a land that I will show them. It always blows my mind when I read verse number one, when God says, I want you to go to a land and I'll tell you where it is when you get there. He didn't tell him what direction to leave town. He said, I want you to leave your country, the people, and go to a land. So he's asking three things of Abraham, right? Uno, dos, tres. Are we with him? Good. Then in verse number two and three, he tells him, I will then give you six things. Now look at me, folks. Look at me. I don't know about apes. And I don't know about dude. It doesn't know the difference between the pie that's round and the cob in the square. Last time I checked it, if God has three things, this man promised to give him six, I believe Abram was getting a good return on his investment. And he don't have to think, don't ever think that God's going to ask more of you than he's going to give to you. Come on, if the sinner on his way to hell, you trust Christ, you go to heaven. It sounds to me like a really good deal. I think people witness to him, talk to him about the soul, and they say, well, I'm not sure. And I would say, not sure about what? Well, I want to think about it. Think about what? Lost sinner going to hell, trust Christ, get saved, going to heaven. What do you want to think about, for goodness sake? And you know what? That principle has to stop, ladies and gentlemen. God asks you to give him something. I guarantee he will replace it with far better than you give him. And in this passage, in verse 2 and 3, God mentions five times that he's going to bless Abraham. And I want to talk to you today. I asked him the same kinds of blessings because I want to talk to you about the principle of what does it mean when we count our blessings. Father, bless this morning. I pray you help us here receive. Thank you for the challenge we receive from our brother, the encouragement. I'm certainly with that one that come. Now help us this morning once again with the blessings of our God upon our lives. Help us this morning. I pray in Christ's name. Count your blessings. Name them one by one, and it will surprise you, but it shouldn't. What the Lord has done. What does that mean to count your blessings? See, well, Pastor Jones, that means to look at all the good stuff in your life. Yeah, but wait a minute. It says a lot about us, about how we count our blessings, what we count as blessings, why we count our blessings. All that, it says a lot about us. Now, look, folks, I know it is a dark day. It's a difficult time. We got the COVID thing with the pandemic thing. We got scared people in political positions. Yeah, we got that. And it's a day of apostasy. It's a day of departure. It's a day of this, and it's a day of that. And I've got all of that. And I don't think it's a wise to turn a blind eye and a deaf ear to all that and say, well, I'm just a blessed person. However, it would seem to me that if we're going to talk about how dark it is, let's talk about how God is good. Right? But what does it say about us when we count our blessings? That Him is a good on Him, and it works because it reminds us that we not only should think about it, we should count it. In other words, God says something about the blessing of God in our life. So let's get right into the message this morning. I got more time. I only got 31 minutes before noon, and then we're done for lunch. By the way, you good people have been feeding us. Thank you. I thank you. The people I have to buy clothes for, thank you. Because now I go home and buy new clothes. The buttons on my shirt are starting to become lethal weapons. I lay down because once we go back to the hotel, in the night's room, I got set on the side of bed on one side of the motel room over there, and I'm on the other side, laid down like a peace whale. Seriously. And then when you got a full stomach, and you lay down, it's like heaven. You can hear the angels. But it's not in my stomach gurgling. I mean, it's unbelievable. But thank you for all the kindnesses, the food, the stuff in the motel room. I didn't get any Diet Coke to prepare it. I would like to said, you know what? It does say we should pay attention to our blessings. Or are they lost in the battle? They see blessings in a battle. There's blessings from a battle. There's blessings through a battle. There's blessings because of a battle. You know, battles are good things, really, to be honest with you. I got another message I might be preaching tonight about the battle that you want. You want, there's certain battles you want to have in life. But in the moment of the battle, it doesn't always seem like a blessing, but it's in there somewhere. And sometimes the battles that we do go through in our life cause us to fail and realize, even in the midst of battles, there's blessings. Even in the midst of a burden, there's blessings. Then Jesus said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden, and I will give you rest, and you shall find rest unto you. It's amazing, even in my burden, I find a Savior. There's a good-bearing Savior who walks with me. You know, there's blessings in that. There's blessings in my battles. There's blessings in my burdens. There's blessings in my losses. I don't see it at the moment, but I'll tell you what, there's still blessings in that. You know, I'm not one of those kind of people. I wish I was more spiritual. I just do. I wish I was one of those kind of people who go out and garage in the morning, get ready to get in the car and go to work and get a flat tire. And I wish I could just say, thank you, Lord. I needed a flat tire this morning. I just needed that so bad. It's not even funny. But I don't do that. I usually speak French. The truth of the matter is, I'm not really bilingual. I'm not even legal, to be honest with you. But I wish I was that way. I those people, you know what I mean? Y'all in the church parking lot, you're getting ready to get in your car. Someone says, hey, brother, how you doing? And you don't pay attention. You slam the door and you slam it on your finger. And what do they do? They spiritual with double hands. All things work together for good, you know. Well, come over here, let me slam your head in the door. You can join me. We can all have the good together. I wish I could do that. I wish I could say every time I'm having trouble, every time I'm having difficulty, every time I'm having a battle, every time I'm having a struggle, every time I lost something, every time I wanted to do something and it didn't work out, I wish it was that way. Your pastor is an A-type personality. He is. That's why he's a very efficient staff member. That's why he's asking, did you take care of this preacher? Did you take it? After all, I quit asking. I would. I just look around and go, oh, he did that. He did this. He did that. I think our first step there. Maybe he doesn't know. I don't know how hard to do. He's not with us anymore. I couldn't believe it. I gave him a man's breakfast to take care of. First one we ever had. I gave him a man's breakfast. I just told him what to do. I said, you want scrambled eggs, pieces of gravy, sawmill gravy, and orange juices. Don't put granola in there. Don't, you know, get some stuff out there. Get something to stick the ribs, Jack. Set up the table at 8 o'clock Saturday morning. Have the food ready. Set the tables up. Get everything done. You're good to go. I showed them to be at church for the, but it was a building we were in. But showed them at 8 o'clock, about 7:45, and nothing. Nobody's there. Doors were locked. The rapture's in. We've been playing church. We unlocked the doors. Tables are not set up. Chairs are not set up. Nothing's done. Well, ready to throw a fit at the moment. I said, oh, hey, let's help them. Let's get this spirit of your fellow. What do you say? Let's get our tables out so we got the tables out. He said, I don't feel like it was no big deal. On the inside, I said, I'm okay. Don't you bring it right there, girl. I'm okay. I'm gonna take one of them plastic knives that he doesn't even have here to kill it with. And when I get one, I'm gonna put it right in front of him. But on the outside, I'm like, let's get the table set up. What do you think, Bill? I said, there's a breakfast at work. How's it going over there? And I walked around the back. We can't have a kitchen in the building, but I walked around to find out, well, maybe he had it in the back room. List the food. Okay. 8 o'clock, 8:15, 8:20, 8:30. He shows up with the of food. He comes in with all pretenders. I'm sorry, I can't believe it. So we get met with the everything set up. We have our breakfast and everything else, and it's all over and done. And he comes up to me afterwards, he goes, I'll preach that next week. I said, well, let's not talk about that right now, but let's talk about that. Later on, he comes back and we get together to have a meeting. He said, preacher, I want to explain to you what happened. I said, no problem. Before you do that, let me ask you a question. Do I have to accept your excuse now? Because if you don't do what you were told to do next time, I'm going to get another scrap of excuses. You know, like, you wanted to show up and you wanted to kill yourself. I mean, well, the blessing of the staff member not getting his job done. You've never been in the game. Yeah, right. Next time I go to make breakfast, he cooked it 2 weeks before and brought it over there again. And we all got to make breakfast. But anyway, see, here's the difference. When we count, I'm blessed, God bless you. When we count, God bless you one more time. Bless you, Father, Son, Holy Ghost, bless you. The truth of the matter is, when we get there, so we count our blessings. It says we're paying attention to them. It says we're looking for those blessings. You have to find the silver lining behind all the clouds. Well, if you're seeing silver behind the clouds, you're going to get your eyes checked, or you're going to have a flashback from the 60s. Something's going on. But the truth of the matter is that there are blessings. There's blessings in the valleys. There's blessings in the battles. There's blessings in the dark midnights. There's blessings in the struggles. They're there. And if we see them, that means we're not just looking. See, that's what happens when you get in a battle. You just see the battle. That's what happens when you're in a struggle. You just see your struggles. That's what happens when you lose something. You just see your loss. What happens when we count our blessings and we see blessings in the midst of all of that? You know what it says? I'm paying attention to the fact that, yeah, there is handfuls of purpose sprinkled out there for us. There's God's goodness that comes along the way. Even if it's just something simple, something little, but it's something we look for. Most of us have blessings that we never notice or appreciate. You know what we say? Well, we don't really appreciate something until it's gone. But I think it's that. Come on, let me have a look. See that right there? See that right there? Yep, I got 10 of those. But smash that one right there. Now, that is a rhetorical statement. Just go, touch me and smash my finger, okay? There's a lot of literal benefits out there. That person just asked me to smash the finger. No, I didn't. It's a never mind. Can't explain everything, don't you? Tell the joke, you have to explain it. I mean, it's a lot of the joke, okay? But if you smash that finger right there, put one of the big old bandages on it. All of a sudden, you didn't wake up in the morning and go, thank God you got a finger on my right hand. Trigger finger. Pointing finger. Finger. No. I got. You never pay attention to that finger until you smash it. Did you ever tell me to touch it? You get a paper because you want your name in the Fox Bookmark. You notice it. All of a sudden, you start paying attention to that finger. You're never paying attention to that finger. You got nine other fingers. They're all working good. You're not going, well, thank God I got fingers on this hand that work. And I got four over here that work, but I don't think they're picking up things on this thing right here. I don't think anything done because they end all of it. See, that's kind of what happens with a blessings thing. We never really pay attention to them. We never notice them. We're not even really looking for them. We're spending so much time in the waiting ambulance complaining about all the junk that we got that we're failing to realize that every day of our trouble, folks, you open your eyes, it's a blessing. You swing your leg over the bed, it's a blessing. If you're feeling like that, you have to use both sides of the bed to get up at one time. But you swing your leg over there, you realize you can pull your britches up, fellas. And put your shoes on, get clothes, get dressed, get ready to go. You got something to do, you got somewhere to go. That's a blessing. Say when we count our blessings. It shows we pay attention. Number two, it shows that we put it in order. So now I'm going to ask you the question. Don't answer it. Just before you answer it, listen to the question. What is your biggest and best blessing? Now we're in church. We all know what that is, right? I want to tell me what it is. 1, 2, 3. Salvation. Absolutely. Without question. And we say in church, question. Is that really the order of our greatest blessing? Man, the Lord, I got that. I got the stimulus check. It's a blessing, Lord. I got that. I got so much unemployment, I don't even have to work. I had one of my guys say that to me. He's funeral next week. I can't stand it. I have more respect for I was raised by my grandparents, second generation people, and work wasn't dirty four-legged work. It was just we enjoyed working. We were active work, all that kind of stuff. Plus, every time he would give us a project, they'd take us out for pizza. I'd take all the way to Panama for big pizza. I would. You throw some biscuits and gravy on the other side, I'll go all the way down to our
going to get served. You know why you can't get served? There are no people to serve you. It's unbelievable to me. So, is that my biggest blessing? I got 300 bucks a week and I don't have to go to work. See, I'm counting my blessings. It says a lot about the order of my blessings. I was preaching in the next week, up in Alaska, first year I preached in the Bible. We had a man come all over Alaska this week. It's really fascinating. I love that man. You know, nothing like preaching 300 men in Alaska. You know, you're not worried about my home church. I don't know about how many. Looks like a reunion for Duck Dynasty, but I don't care. I can't grow a facial hair. I'm Cherokee. I can't grow a tribal. I'm sick with it. Nasty. All the attention has been disappointed with me. I'll show you the picture, but I'm trying to grow a goat. I couldn't grow. You guys got hair. I don't care if you got hair on your face. So I need to smooth it. Anyway, so I finished the meeting on Saturday morning. I had to get literally run out of the meeting and jump in a truck, get to the airport, and get on a plane to fly home late night, Saturday night, get home from church. And this mate cuts me off as we're driving out of the truck. Cuts us off. Hey, Prince, wait a minute, I got something for you. There is a guy sitting in his truck, he pulls out this case. What a great case. Opens the case, and there he is. A gold-plated, ruby black heart, 44 magnet pistol. Engraved by the man, by the man in Fairbanks, who founded Fairbanks last year. This is the government shop. And he goes, Preacher, I've got to tell you. Sales slip because I had to go to the airport and put it in a suitcase and get it in the airport flight home. You have to go through security and all that kind of junk. So I got him for the meeting. Folks are asking, put your house in the meeting. What's it going to play in the testing? Oh, it's a fact that sick man got sick. What is the order of your blessings when you count? What's the order? What is it? But I always try to think about my salvation. You have to think about that. You have to think about that. When we talk about taking things for granted, salvation's got to be number one. That's why the Bible says in Hebrews, how shall we escape if we neglect so-so salvation? I'm going to stay with the so-so salvation. I got saved as a 9-year-old boy, Frank. I hadn't been a real deep sinner. I had sinned enough to know I was lost and going to hell. I started shoplifting, stealing, drank liquor before I was a little boy. All that kind of stuff. Yeah, I've been there, done that, all that kind of stuff. I got saved. You know, I don't care if I got saved at 5 or 50. If I got saved from sin, hey, everybody else got saved. So I don't think all of you, I got saved when I was 6, so I don't think I appreciate it. Well, you better back up and think about it. Because if you realize you were lost, and you were 6 years old, and you didn't trust Christ, you'd have died and gone to hell. But you trusted Christ, God saved you from the same hell, he saved the trumpet from, he saved us all from the same hell. And when we start to count our blessings, for goodness sakes, our order, I'll start with Jesus and salvation. Now, we'll say that in church, but think about it for a moment. You're alone. Nobody's around. Just you and God. And you start to count your blessings. What's the word? Number 3. You want to count your blessings, says the Bible. It says what your priorities are. Not only what's on your list, but what is it? Is that on your list? I want to start my prayer time. I sit on the airplane here one day. This guy's talking on his phone. Okay, Joe. When I get back to the office, will you go and stop and look up? That's the way out loud he was talking. I'm sitting there going, really? Oh, yeah, wait a minute. Let me get something. I got another call here. Yeah. I want you to tell you just like that. That's the way he was talking. I tried. Ladies and gentlemen, I have a terminal cord case of sarcasm. I can't help myself. In fact, I know God wanted me to help you.
said, you can't help because we're over there with the family. People on the plane climb up to it. Nobody messes with me today. Is that my blessing? Because that's going to happen. Wherever you go, I get out of my life. You get up in the morning, you read your Bible, you spend some time with the Lord, you got the Holy Ghost all over you. It's a day. Sun shining, birds singing, Jesus is on the throne, everything's good. Then you get behind the wheel of your car and you start driving down the street and some fool, where you got nowhere to go, and there's no way to get there, it gets in front of you. I'm with all these people coming to America, but similar to some of these people where the gas pedal is on American-made cars. Or if you're from Oregon or Washington, don't drive to California. Because those idiots come from those states, they get in the pass limit, and they won't pull over. And they got the nerve to drive the speed limit. That would be the death penalty. You want to get on a jury today? Put on your jury form. I believe in death penalty for parking lot tickets. You're out. That's why we don't show appreciation to each other. What is he supposed to do that? Oh, you're romantic, don't you? We don't call you romantic. The truth of the matter is, the trouble is, what about that? Well, he's supposed to work particularly well for you. Yeah, but then he does. The priority of our blessing says a whole lot about us. The Bible says, Proverbs 48:20, a faithful man shall abound with blessings. How's the Lord doing? Preacher, give me a thought. When he said, I wrote it down, I was preaching this, he only with this one. He daily loaded us with big things. When you made that statement, I wrote down, let's check our load. That was what I preached. I'll call the Jordan Bell Center when I get down here, okay? Check the matter is, here we go. But my priorities, my blessings, are where I put them on my list. Shows what really my priorities really are. Watch it. Well, I'm just thankful for my health. Is that the first thing you're thankful for, your health? Is that a good thing to be thankful for, people? Well, you better believe it. Oh, yeah. Is that the first thing? Is that top of the list, man? Our blessing, your priority of blessings are what they give you, what you get from it, what you have. See, that's the popular Christianity today. You can't get a Christianity. I don't want to come to church, I want to feel what I get, what I have, what I get, what I'm knowing, what I'm feeling, what I want. I get what I want, I get up and I go home. That's it. Maybe that's shallow Christianity. They have nothing to that stuff. What about the fact that my list of priorities and my blessings show they really do indicate to me where I'm at spiritually in my life? Because if it starts with me, the test is already wrong. What does it say about carrying my blessings? And what else it says a lot about your faith. What really are your blessings? Are they only good if it's what you wanted, what you never expected, what benefited you, what prospered you, what helped you? Okay, it's easy for us to say this to church. Not all blessings seem like blessings when they come into your life. Like when somebody leaves the church, right? No preacher wants folks to leave church except me. But the truth is, I'll be honest with you, I found out a long time ago, we have never had a person leave our church that didn't need to. It wasn't best for them or for us somewhere down the road. And it's not always kind of a bad situation. I think good people move away. And that kind of stuff. And down the road, I found out that it was better that they weren't there at that particular time. And it was good for them. So if it was good for them, it must have been good for us, too. I mean, that's all well, fine, and good. But is it a blessing? Come on, folks, another thing that says, is it a blessing that someone died? father in law right now is that close to him. That close. A man I hunted and fished with, and he's a little guy, but he was, you get up in the mountains and hunt with this dude, you couldn't keep up with him. I mean, he was a goer and a goer. We got a lot of gun bags together, him and I, was most of them were animals. The truth is, he was never a big, strong, or heavy, strapping type guy. He was a healthy man. Not as much as 100 pounds, just skin. And now we're just watching that thing wither away. Blessing. Take a blessing. See, man, he's been so good to us. A lot about your faith, don't you? Stand beside a guy. Our daughter, Bethany, her husband, after they got married, all I got to see is the baby, the child, and the baby. I think I told you the story before. The baby had an encephaly. The skull was not developed, and they had the other food that the woman eats the brain. Yet the baby grows. And dies in an outbreak of just right after that. Healthy woman, strong, little body. From the time of the diagnosis, about 2 months, 3 months into it, that baby was going to die. But the baby grew. She got pregnant. People would ask her, you expect your baby to have the baby shot? They didn't want her. So they had to have all the questions people ask when someone's expecting. Knowing that baby was going to die. Remember, I took sea life from the first. Little Claire Grace Parker came into this world and died in moments. She left her mom. In a hospital, we might be two dozens of times a month. Listen. Young couple who did it right. They honored God for their engagement and everything else. They honored God. And their first baby. Put in a little white casket like this. But my man, what we're pretty much built in for her. Now I went over to the funeral home where they had the little body and they took that little body inside that casket. They gave me some pictures of things they wanted to put in there for her. And then we took it over to the cemetery. And one of the very few times I don't want to be a pastor for one of those things. I want to sit with the family and cry like everybody else did. And it's still with that little casket there. And we'll serve for Claire Grace. Should be 13, you see. But listen. They went out of the hospital to go get some in the car. Baby's up there with the mom and dad and the grandpa's and grandma's and all gathered around there. And I went to get something for them out of the car. They had come taking the baby's body. As I walk out, I get in the elevator, a young couple gets on the elevator. Guy's standing there, tattoos all over him, bridges pulled down, underwear sticking on that, set hand on sideways. The girl sitting in that wheelchair, she couldn't do that much, her carrying a little red flea stuff in the bed. She could have been 13. But here's some dude, and some little girl, and they got a healthy, big red face in the bed. By the way, I didn't, I wasn't. With that, I thought, thank God that baby's healthy and everything's good. But I'm standing in the elevator when they go outside, he pops a cigarette in his mouth, curses, and pushes her on down. sit down and I'll say, now, God, I really don't need to see that. I'm going to go up there a little bit. When you look at the circumstances and the situation, you don't always see the blessing at the moment. You know how many times my son-in-law and daughter have helped young couples through situations just like that? Scores of times. It's almost 13 years. Dozens of young couples that have been able to help them. You know why? Because they stayed faithful, they did right, they went home. Did it seem like a blessing at the moment? Home with a white casket like that? No way. Put on a little table by a gravesite? See that couple going out the door like that? Nope. Realize that God, that was God's will. But was it still a blessing? Yes! Because it should not alter our faith or our confidence that God knows what He's doing. Hey, that Romans 8:28 thing looks funny. You know what? It looks peculiar at different times. It looks different in the hospital room. It looks different in the cemetery. It looks different in a nursing home. It looks different when you change it from grown man's diaper. It looks different. But all things do still work together for good. To them that love God, to them all the called according to His purpose. There's two sides of Romans 8:28. There's God's side and there's my side. God's side, all things work together for good. Don't get over there. Don't walk over there. Don't wander over there. Don't worry over there. Don't fret over there. Don't question over there. And don't get over there and try to do God's part. God will do His part. All things work together for good. That's right, friend. All things. I look at that word all the time. You know what it means? All, just like the King James Bible says. All the good, the bad, the better, the sweet, the high, and the low, the dark, and the light. All of it works together for good. But see, that's not my job. That's God's job. My job is to love Him and live in His purpose. See, that makes all things work together for good. Eventually, something comes out of that that God determines is good. That's the thing about Romans 8:28 is, it's His good, not mine. It's not good to be a good mind. It's not good to watch a healthy man wither away my life slowly. What's good about that to us? But for some reason, it's good to Him. And for some reason, it's good to God, it's good to me. And how you count your blessings really does show your faith. Loss can be a blessing. Suffering can be a blessing. First Peter says it makes you perfect, stand and strengthen, so you have to actually suffer a lot. I was reading this preacher here, so I'm not different than you can help me with this on YouTube or a college. You know, when God restored Job, in 2000, it never says it gave him health back. And I said, but he didn't give him. He had 2 times what he lost, gave him 10 more kids on the first place. And all that, God restored Job, but didn't say he healed him. With that awful affliction. Oh. The truth of the matter is, ladies and gentlemen, see, it says a lot to our faith when we count our blessings. If you wait long enough for God to bring good out of something that doesn't look like a blessing at all, you give time to will. Yes, He will. It says a lot about our faith. It says a lot about our trust. One more thing we're done this morning. Genesis 12, verse 2 says, and thou shall be a blessing. How we count our blessings reveals if we really learn why we're blessed. Thou shall be a blessing. Abraham, I'm going to bless you. I'm going to give you another name. Weary and sad. Gather the sunshine where darkness is strong. Make me the sorrow and glad. Make me a blessing. Make me a blessing. See, that's it. We got that. We got that. Give me, give me. Come on, God's got a blessing. There's nothing wrong with asking for blessings. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with wanting God to bless you. You're dumb and simple. I don't want God to bless you. I want God to bless me. I want to appreciate Him. I want to notice Him. I want to pay attention to Him. But He did not give me blessings to be blessed. He gave me blessings so I can bless somebody with what I've been blessed with in my life. counting your blessings. You never count the fact that you got to be a blessing to somebody else. Huh? See, that says a lot about our blessings. Is that even on your list? Man, I got this, I got that, I got all this blab and grab and shit and pay your preachers. You give me $1, I'm going to give you $1,000. Well, why don't you give me $1,000 and then get the fuck out of the place? I'll give you a bucket. The truth is that this idea is somehow or another. All you want to talk about is what you get out of God, what you get from God, how you get this from God. How about this one? When was the last time you counted your blessing on that list way up there? Was God blessed me with something? And you know what? I was able to bless somebody else. That's why so many of us, we lack blessings. Because why is God going to give it to you? You're the dead sin. You've been there. Just a big, salty, nasty, stinking pool of water. We took the folks over there with some of us went to Israel. They tell you, get in that, you can literally float in it without the flotation device. Which I can do anyway because I got my own flotation device. But you land there and you get that mud, you rub it on it, it's good for your pores and all this kind of stuff. It's nasty, brackish water because the Jordan River flows in, but it has no outlet. See, that's us where the deep sea blessing. Well, God can bless me. Hold on, now I want to ask you a question. When you get blessed with something, what do you do with that? Is that just you? You got yours? I got mine. Is that it? See, if you count your blessings and on the list, way up there now, way up there, even above the government stimulus package, way up there now, you got that thing up. You know what? God gave me something. I got to share that with somebody. I got to help somebody with this. I got to bless somebody with what God blessed me with. When you count your blessings, you count the times of being a blessing to somebody else and blessing somebody else in their life. Let me just say this to you too, by the way, friend, listen very carefully. When you're not being blessed, one of the best ways to get blessed is to bless somebody else. Years back when we started our church, I started going to a nursing home, one of the areas of our soul. So I go every Thursday. These patients did breaks at the nursing home. First room I walked into, I said, good morning, how are you? Huh? I said, good morning, how are you? Huh? I said, good morning, how are you today? I'm fine, how are you? A couple rooms like that. Third room, I walked in and go, good morning, how are you this morning? This lady looked at me, she goes, I'm fine, where are you yelling at me? It's not suffering. Every week I go to that nursing home, this one lady, I go see her. And part of the patients are visiting home. And I said, Mary, because I hear the little name tag on the outside the door. I called her Mary for like 6 months. And then she goes, did you know that my name is Elizabeth? I said, Elizabeth Mary or Mary Elizabeth? She goes, no. I said, please, I've been calling you Mary for 6 months. She goes, I don't like the name. I always wanted to be called Mary. I said, well, girl, you're Mary from now on. You got to tell me you're Mary. I don't care what they put on the door out there. You're Mary. So this couple started going with me from our church. After day one, they didn't want to go anymore. She said, I don't get a blessing anymore. I said, we're not going to give you one. We're going to give you one. Yeah, I don't smell bad. People don't always know what to do. I said, thanks for waking up. Good morning. Get out of here! I'm taking it off, man. I go, I said, watch it. I stand on your elbows and talk to me like that. Because you're going to go, here's a blessing. Get out of here! I said, I just came to say, no, I don't care. Why don't you leave me alone? I said, because I wanted to be a blessing to you. But if you don't watch it, I'm going to pull you out of that chair and lay you on the floor and walk out of here. What do you think about that? He goes, oh, okay. It became a little friendly. Hey, buddy, how are you doing this morning? I'm fine. I'm fine. I'm just fine. See, that's why people, they just go through life. That's why people spend all their time on the telephone. That's why they spend all the time in their little world. They got their little world, but that's all they ever think about, is their little stupid world. They still bother with people. It's so aggravating watching. Why are they so dumb? They're walking across the street talking on the telephone. And I mean, do you realize you could be a little woman and somebody's 56'4"? Really, think about it for a moment. They can't even put the phone down long enough to walk across the kind of biggest street. They're spending all the time on their phone. They're in their little world. That's all they think about. They're on their phone. They're talking. Oh, man, I'm going to hurry up. My wife and I were flying. something, they're talking, but they're talking real loud. And they'll get, oh, come on, I'm just kidding. But, and then I'll talk loud. They're blind, so I'm blind, I'm going to play. But as they were talking, they were doing the hair flipping things, you know what I mean? So they're going to hear them go, oh, let's see, woo. And my wife's going, and I said, what's that? I'm a lot more patient with than you may think. They kept talking about they're going to Dallas to go to some convention, a conference, and we want them to respect us because we're professionals. One of us wears kind of short shirts and gets up to get something out of the pen, and there's a belly button right here. I always sit on my own. I got them talking loud, took the seats back, and my wife is the sweetest thing on this planet. But when you're ready to land, the steward says, now put your seat back in the breakfast station and the trailer. Then you hear that. My wife goes, wow, here's the seat. She said, you know, she said, put your seat up. I just looked at my wife and said, what are you doing? She said, that's enough of that. Sorry, he said, I know. Okay, that's not a problem.